Hi, folks. Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lifteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lifteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy.
Dana, welcome to Next Economy Now.
Thank you for having me.
First off, I just have to say that your work is extremely important right now. It's extremely impactful. I'm grateful that you're doing the work you're doing. And Justice Funders was founded nearly 10 years ago, and you've recently had a significant evolution. I'm curious if you could share with our listeners about the organization's origins, and so, you know, what you do, your origins, and your recent evolution.
Great. Thank you so much. We actually started as the Bay Area Justice Funders Network following the murder of Oscar Grant, where the grant makers who became our founding steering committee met each other in the street of one of the actions and quickly determined that there needed to be an entity that was able to organize in moments of crisis like what had happened with Oscar, and that more importantly, that there needed to also be continuous conversation within philanthropy about not just how we respond to crisis, but actually how we get out in front and create the kind of culture and practice within philanthropy that actually creates more of a restorative justice culture in the communities that we work in and that we're a part of.
Tell our listeners just a little bit more about the specifics of what you do, just so they can get a picture of how you're evolving now and what are some tangible ways that you're catalyzing that culture shift that you describe.
Sure. So Justice Funders is a partner and guide for philanthropy in reimagining practices that advance a thriving and just world. And what that looks like is we are an organization who supports philanthropy through programming, through leadership development, and through consulting to really think about how we ground in values-aligned practice. And so what that looks like for us is how do we think about the ways in which philanthropy as a field has been created by the extractive economy. We see philanthropy as being a product of industries of extraction and exploitation, all the way back to the wealth that came from slavery and stolen land from indigenous people and the systemic undervaluing of women's work. And so because the wealth comes from these origins, we believe that there is also ways in which the philanthropic practice itself still supports and still relies on this kind of extraction in order for the philanthropy institution to be able to continue to do its work. And so for us, a lot of what we try to do is really dig into and interrogate the values of philanthropy. And so if we really believe in justice and equity, how does that manifest in our practice? What does that look like? We talk about the ways in which we can make our applications less cumbersome. We talk about the ways in which decision-making can be made differently. We talk about how to co-create strategy with our community partners. And a lot of that work was initially about how to make philanthropy better in our extractive system. And I have to credit a lot of our movement allies like Movement Strategy Center and Movement Generation, who through deep relationship with us also asked us, well, how are we using our role and perch in philanthropy to imagine and think about how philanthropy could actually be structured differently? And so for us, when we were getting posed these loving questions about how we were also calibrating the range of response to the need that we see in the world, it invited us to reimagine who we were as the Bay Area Justice Funders Network. And it was actually just a year and a half ago that we've now transitioned into Justice Funders. So going from a regional organization with a couple of programs to now a national organization with several programs.
I love it. So you're basically saying, A, just because you have the money doesn't mean that you're better or that you know how it needs to be spent. Really, it's grassroots organizations. And talk a little bit, you have a Just Transition framework. Talk a little bit about that and how that informs your work.
Building on the wisdom of our movement organizations who for a year have been on the front lines of experiencing the failures of a market economy, they really helped us ground into, so how do we actually envision a world that honors the sacredness of our natural resources and recognizes the inalienable rights of all? And when we thought about what that looks like outside of what we currently know as our economy and what we currently understand as the field of philanthropy, it helped us think about, well, then what would it take actually to create that world? And so once we pulled back and we took a step back to reflect on the vision that was put forward by Movement Generation and the Climate Justice Alliance for a Just Transition, we started thinking about, well, what would a just transition for philanthropy look like? And so that enabled us to then come up with some clarity around the fact that we believe that philanthropy must take an active role in building the world that we need by redistributing all aspects of well-being, democratizing power, and shifting economic control to communities. And so for us, that has now really been grounded in our newest work, which is called Resonance. It is a framework for philanthropic transformation. And it really is about taking the larger vision and values for a just transition into philanthropy to really look at the 7 different levers that philanthropy can utilize to move from a more extractive practice to a more restorative and regenerative practice.
Wonderful. And I think a lot of our listeners may be pretty comfortable with this assessment that market economy, there's a lot of failures entrenched in that. But I think it's interesting that you're actually getting a lot of critique, and the folks that are pushing back against this resonance framework are saying, well, you know, look at all the benefits of capitalism. And could you talk a little bit about how you respond to those arguments and how you're asserting that response?
I would say that especially in the last year, there have been a number of notable critics looking at the ways in which market solutions have failed. Last year, Anand Giridharadas illuminated in Winners Take All the fact that elites have been the ones to capitalize on the opportunity and promise of a free market, and that growing wealth inequality, housing displacement, community gentrification are all indicators that the market economy is responsible for creating the very conditions we find ourselves in. And I think similarly, one of our colleagues in philanthropy, Edgar Villanueva of the Schott Foundation, has articulated in Decolonizing Wealth that we have culturally a history of looking at money through colonization, and that the way that we engage with each other is actually really colonized. And so how do we stop using extractive practices and to begin incorporating the kinds of restorative practices that field practitioners like Amaka Agbo center in their practice around creating shared ownership, governance, and self-determination for a just transition to the next economy? And those are some of the things that I think when we hear about market solutions, we actually look at them as false solutions. I think some of our folks from It Takes Roots came up with three ways to support philanthropy in coming up with an alternative or a way of sussing out the false solutions. And there are three simple questions anyone can ask when kind of being presented with these questions, which is, who benefits, right? So knowing that all social justice issues have roots in systemic and racial economic inequity, who would benefit from the possible solution being proposed? Another question to ask would be, who makes the decisions? So knowing that those closest to the problems will inevitably know the most about what the solutions need to look like, who actually is guiding the decisions that need to be made about the economy? And then what else will this impact? And then sometimes I feel like a lot of our conversations revolve around really narrowly focused single issue solutions, which really can undermine progress on other issues that we care about. And so the way that we look at what else will this impact is to consider who owns, who profits, and who benefits from whatever the solution being proposed is. And so I think that those are some of the ways we respond to thinking about how to examine what is being proposed and how to think about it differently.
And how are you seeing those principles and those guidelines, how are they landing in the philanthropic sector? What do you see philanthropy needing to do in order to align the actual practices with these values?
I think that we have been well received outside of, you know, the more extreme folks who would, you know, apply a more critical lens. I think most folks recognize that what we've been doing for the last 100 years hasn't been working, that actually most of the issues that philanthropy is trying to support in making a difference around have actually gotten worse, right? All of our indicators are indicating worsening conditions on the ground. And so we really approach working with our colleagues from, you know, starting with where folks are at. How do you deepen the conversation wherever you are and apply the goal of becoming more regenerative? So it's like we all know that each foundation will have a different starting point, that where they end up in their process may look different and probably will look different from their peers, and that's okay. We really try to apply, you know, a developmental approach to working with folks, and we also understand that this is going to take time. These are not situations that folks found themselves in overnight, and it's not going to be changed tomorrow. So it's going to take all of us working together for a number of years in order to make these leaps. I think the thing that we do carry, though, is what our field partners on the ground would say in terms of we need to calibrate the scale of response to the scale of need. And so the urgency that we feel in provoking these conversations is really about the fact that we all have to start now, be very clear with where we're trying to go, and that the developmental process to there may look different and be, you know, different for each institution, but that we really need to start transforming our individual and institutional worldviews on the underlying assumptions of the role of capital. And so understanding that in market economies, there's often a belief that individuals and institutions have a right to endlessly accumulate capital and to make decisions on how it should be allocated for the public good. And we try to posit that in regenerative economies, the underlying assumption should really be that capital must support the collective capacity of communities most impacted by economic inequality to produce for themselves. And that those are the places at which we try to, you know, focus on where we're at, where we're trying to go, and work with folks in between to kind of get there.
It reminds me so much of our recent podcast guest, Terha Ak, who said, you know, really focus on this idea of self-determination. There's so many questions coming up for me right now. I guess the one that's most alive is, you know, what would that practically look like on the ground if philanthropy were to shift in this way? And even maybe, you know, feel free to go into some of your vision of how that could change the economy, maybe even, you know, in decades or just looking at a longer term horizon.
Well, I feel fortunate in that we actually have some real stories of foundations who are starting to hold that question and really make important decisions. So Sonia Swift, who is one of the trustees of the Swift Foundation, said that one of the questions that they as an institution grappled with would be, what does it look like when we decide to stop accumulating wealth? So recognizing that for most foundations who either have an endowment, if they're a private foundation, or even if they are a public foundation, have investments as institutions that are holding sizable wealth, what does it look like when they decide to stop accumulating that, right? So like, what if you made different decisions about how you were going to deploy that capital? So as an example, Swift has made the decision to maintain their endowment at their current size. So that means that they're not prioritizing endless growth. And that means they also have more money that they can give away now, right? So these are tangible examples. I think some other lessons we've learned from partnering with field practitioners like Amaka Agbo is that philanthropy actually is well suited to be the early stage of funding in integrated capital stack. And it helps to position communities and projects that often get denied access to more traditional forms of capital due to credit scores or non-traditional community ownership structures. And so like when we think about how philanthropy can actually take its resources out of Wall Street and put it in the hands of folks who are on the ground in their communities, what other benefits will we see in terms of both the structural change of who has decision-making power, who has the ability to determine what their community looks like, and eventually who can govern? Even on the C3 side, on the grant-making side, I think philanthropy can also provide early-stage support for educating and training local leaders on how to access or come up with business plans in order to create a different model for how they structure their organizations. It doesn't have to be in a typical 501c3 structure. So those are some of the ways in which we see philanthropy being able to make a difference now, and also being able to use a lot of the tools that are at their disposal. So besides grants, there's also program-related investments, mission-related investments, the ability to deploy investment dollars in a project. So I think that there's actually a lot that philanthropy can start doing now in order to be a more active catalyst.
Really appreciating, and I'm sure our listeners are appreciating you bringing in what is beyond grant capital, the PRIs, MRIs, patient capital. And I'm curious if you could share, since many nonprofits are reliant on institutional foundations, what does Justice Funders have as a vision for philanthropic transformation and how that can transform social justice movements? Where are you seeing the move from not just being exclusively reliant on grant capital?
I think it's important to name that historically, when Congress created institutional philanthropy by essentially approving a tax shelter for wealth, it in turn also created the nonprofit industrial complex, right? So when we look at the last 100 years and the way that both institutional philanthropy has evolved over time and the dependence of some of the most radical work in our country being consolidated in a C3 structure in order to get the resources to do the work, we're seeing the ways in which, at this point, capital is constraining systems change. And so I think the important thing for us to now have simultaneous conversations with our movements as we are in philanthropy is to really think about how do we reimagine the kind of ecosystem support for local work that is actually generated from our neighbors rather than from institutional philanthropy. And so one of the projects that Justice Funders is now leading is an action lab called Movement Commons, where we are actively pursuing some experiments, really, actually on two different levels. So the first is an experiment on What would it look like for institutional philanthropy to take the strategy of folks on the ground? So I think we often hear some of the worst case examples of where a group of funders will get together. They'll say, oh, we have this great idea for how we can do X, Y, or Z. They put a pot of money together, and then we hear horror stories from our frontline groups who are either forced to collaborate in order to get a little bit of money or to do work that's really outside the bounds of what they were planning on doing in order to be resourced. And so as a response to the growing gentrification in the Bay Area and seeing very siloed responses, some of our local leaders called on us to say, hey, are your funders paying attention to what's happening here? And great that now we have some strategies around affordable housing, or great now that we have some strategies on, you know, broader transportation. But this is actually a power building question. And we were like, oh, how are you seeing this? You know, and we were informed, well, look at, you know, sort of the history of the Bay Area and California politics. The reason why California has been such a progressive stronghold is that we have developed a very mature constellation of movement organizations who are able to activate year-round, and not just when elections happen, but are also able to provide constant political education, leadership development to local leaders, and get community members out to the polls during election season. Well, guess who's getting pushed out of our urban cores, right? These are the folks that are the organized folks who provide the most progressive votes on all of our issues statewide. And once these folks are pushed out of the urban core into outer areas where they can afford to live, what does this mean for our organized based in the Bay Area? So one of the things that we started to experiment with was, well, hey, how could we provide a container for both lifting up your strategy, which is that we need a regional response, as well as calling in the relationships that we had in philanthropy to be able to help create a community-led collaborative for broader power building. And so Bay Rising is a local example of one of those collaboratives. Lift Up Contra Costa is an example of that, where it was really a coalition of community groups who came up with what the strategy is, and we helped to align the philanthropic resources to support that strategy. So now this is 4 years in the making, and we've been really pleased to be able to demonstrate that it's possible for philanthropy to follow movements and achieve great success. In Contra Costa, we now have the first African-American DA, and that is a super powerful example of where good organizing gets us better results for our communities. In terms of looking at what we need to do to also support our movements, the other project that Movement Commons is really surfacing right now is, what if we began to think about building the level of political education and activation at the individual donor level that we do for our base members? So how can we get all of our local supporters to not only be active in supporting our work, but supporting the work of our allies? And so what would it look like for us to actually build ecosystems of donors who are involved in supporting multiple organizations or an alliance and a base group, because they saw the direct connection between what it takes to build power for their community? So if we instead focus on building the individual and community capacity to support our movement work, it then relies less on institutional philanthropy. And so I think we see that as sort of a paired strategy for what needs to happen in order for us to actually achieve the just transition.
You're saying there's a number of things I just want to tease out for our listeners, because they're so incredibly important. The first feels like, I just see this pattern as replicated in so many areas of our lives. And you mentioned this idea that money can actually follow the leadership of grassroots communities, and that the decision-making around the strategy has to be led from the grassroots, not kind of conjured up in this, you know, separate siloed boardroom and then imposed upon a grassroots organizing base. Is that kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah. It's... Yeah. I mean, strikes me as like that is something that we would do well to employ in so many different aspects of our lives above and beyond philanthropy, but certainly as that pattern seems to be so present. And the other piece that I heard you mention, which is fascinating to me, is this broadening of the tent in a way of looking at institutional philanthropy, but looking at it running in partnership with individual donors. It was really helpful for me to hear your vision of that and how that can effectively support the leadership of grassroots organizations.
Thank you.
Kind of continuing on, and maybe before we continue, I'm also curious around the name Resonance. Do you have anything to share about how you came across that name of Resonance as a framework?
Yeah. It actually is a companion piece to the choir book, which is actually one of our very first joint projects with pairing groups of funders and groups of frontline leaders together to co-create what we hope is some best thinking about how philanthropy could be better, different, more effective. So when Bay Area Justice Funders Network was first starting, we had an advisory group of frontline leaders who were helping us devise our strategy. And as a part of that process, we kept hearing from them, well, it's so great that you are working, you know, to organize social justice funders, but do you think you could work on the folks outside the choir? And that continued to be a pretty common refrain even outside of our advisory committee. And so I chose to use that as actually a question that I felt like I should take back into philanthropy. So I was like, well, hey, we're new. Maybe there is a choir somewhere and I just don't know. So let me go and find these folks and see if I can join. And when I posited this question to several notable leaders in philanthropy who, you know, I was like, well, if there's any choir in social justice philanthropy, these folks would be in it. And I remember getting laughed in my face. And the more funny response that I share is that, you know, the analogy is not so much that there is a choir in social justice philanthropy, Dana. It's that we have some really great solo artists. And I was like, oh, what do you mean? And the response was, well, if you look at it, a lot of the folks that are typically propped up in philanthropy are the folks for whom themselves have a very clear analysis of what they see as the response to what needs to happen. And those folks, you know, are the ones who take leadership, but those are not folks for whom, even if you look at the rest of the institution, match sort of the politic of the rest of the institution, or in fact, you know, match some of the other colleagues even in that space. And I was like, wow, that's pretty amazing, both in terms of like what that assessment was at that moment, but also it was striking to me that here movement had a very different perception and analysis of what they thought, what the infrastructure inside of philanthropy looked like. And it was at that moment that there was that clarity for me about, well, actually the folks within the field didn't even think that we had the infrastructure needed to sufficiently organize. And so that became a project for us in terms of getting a handful of grant makers who work at the intersection of capacity building and leadership together, as well as a handful of frontline leaders who also work in capacity building and leadership primarily, but who could speak to, you know, being on the receiving end of a lot of the kind of grant kind of conversations. And so we tried to create a committee of folks for whom I was like, well, if we need to create the choir, what is that going to look like? And so they were tasked with actually creating the choir book. And we chose eventually as a final product to keep that name because we felt like that was really what we are attempting to do. So that became a framework for social justice philanthropy. We called that the choir book. Against that, we developed a leadership development program for grantmakers called the Harmony Initiative. We're now in our fourth year, just finished recruiting for our fifth year of Harmony West. Harmony East starts in June of this year, and in partnership with Neighborhood Funders Group, we will be launching Harmony Midwest in 2020. All to say that once that body of work was completed, and we then looked to create the framework for a just transition for philanthropy, we really thought about, well, what are we trying to do? And I think what we wanted to do was really to create the intensification of the work that we saw happening within our Just Transition field partners. And so it was like, oh, okay, so resonance would be that body of work that's really about creating that supplementary vibration in philanthropy that should intensify the work on the ground. And so that's how we came up with the name for Resonance, and that is actually serving as the basis for our new executive and trustee program called Maestra, in which we're working with executives and trustees around making some of the dynamic shifts within their organizations from a more extractive place to hopefully a more regenerative one.
I love that, deepening and intensifying the impact on the ground. So we usually start our podcast with this question, but now that our listeners have heard really a quite radical and transformational perspective that you share that is informing the work you're doing, I'm curious if you could share with us how you got into this work. What is your personal story, and how did you catalyze this shift in yourself, or where did this shift come from for you to really recognize the systemic transformation you wanted to see in the world?
So I am born and raised in the Bay Area, and as a fourth generation Japanese American, all of my paternal family was subject to incarceration during World War II without any due process. My father was actually born behind barbed wire in this country because of the fact that his parents happened to be Japanese American. And so for my own journey, I am both very much, I think, come from a place of feeling deep responsibility with my own family's history and story, because I know from even our current moment that it happens again, it happens constantly, and that if we're not vigilant, that we will see the kind of gross injustice that's happening now at the border continue. And so I think it's up to those of us who have the ability to use whatever perch that we can to make the change. I will also just say that aside from, you know, my family and community lineage, I have been fortunate to actually have been organized by some of our wonderful local movement leaders. And it comes from both being in deep relationship with folks, as well as being in constant curiosity about how do we think about our world and our work differently? How do we bring that lens into what we do? And I want to just say that I think my journey is one that has just been fortunate to, you know, have grown up supported by strong local movement leaders here. And that fortunately, when I landed in philanthropy, that I was also really embraced and cared for by some of the folks in social justice philanthropy who helped create for me the guidepost for what Justice Funders has become, and who keeps me accountable in terms of where Justice Funders needs to go. And so that's a little bit about how I came to the work and some of the questions that I'm holding.
That's great. And you said earlier that philanthropy, apart from some kind of, you call them extreme critics, much of philanthropy is starting to respond to work that you and others are bringing to the table. And I'm sure our listeners would be curious to hear, what more can our listeners do to support you in this work and allow this work to spread and infuse more out into the world?
Well, we would welcome folks to engage with any of our programs. We still have the Bay Area Justice Funders Network, which remains a local network here in the Bay Area for folks who have grant-making portfolios that are based here in the Bay or have portfolios here in the Bay. In terms of deepening your grant-making practice, we have Harmony West, East, and Midwest. For folks who are interested and are at the trustee or executive level, we have our Maestra Leadership Development Program. And we also provide coaching and consulting for individuals and institutions in philanthropy. You can find us online at www.justicefunders.org or on Twitter at Justice Funders. And so just welcome further engagement with our work, and also just would say that, you know, we are guided by some of our foremost frontline practitioners. So just also would shout out the work of Amaka Agbo, shout out to the work of Aaron Tanaka and the Center for Economic Democracy out in Boston, our folks at the Climate Justice Alliance and Movement Generation and Movement Strategy Center here in the Bay. All these folks are working really hard to imagine that just transition and make that possible. And I think we're just happy to be allied in that work.
Thank you, Dana. And just as we bring our conversation to a close, is there any other words of advice or remarks that you would make to listeners around how they should be thinking about or engaging in this transition toward an economy that works for the benefit of all life?
I would say, as a relatively newer practitioner to this work myself, that I think it can feel pretty daunting to be able to enter and feel like you can have an instant mastery. So I would just encourage folks to stay curious, to recognize that this work is happening across the country. In fact, I would articulate that actually the new economy is already here. Whether or not we choose to see it is a different story, but that it requires us to build deep relationships with the folks who are doing the work. It requires us to really imagine how we steward, control, and manage our capital differently, and that there are other ways that not only can we do philanthropy, but that we can also be in good allyship with communities who are actually trying to govern now. And I think that that's one of the exciting things that I feel like has become true in the last few years, is that we're actually seeing the alternatives coming out of the Boston Ujima Project, looking at creating the very first democratically governed investment fund in the U.S. We see examples in the Bay Area like Restore Oakland. So just looking around and seeing the new economy, next economy is already here, excites me. And I just invite folks to check out this work and get involved.
I love that. Yeah. Edgar Villanueva in Decolonizing Wealth talks about, we're doing this work anyways. The opportunity is for you to get on board.
Yes.
So thank you so much, Dana. Really appreciate your time and your commitment and your passion, and the whole network that you're a part of is definitely inspiring to us here at Lyft Economy. And now our listeners get to know about it too. So thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. And thank you for doing this work. It's awesome.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lifteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.